Hello and good evening, and thank you for joining my talk at this. It's almost late night, I think, or it's very close to the social event. Image is gone, so it's just one thing. I'm Maximilian Berghoff, and I think the introduction told a lot of me. So if you want to contact me, you will get the slides, and there are some links at the end. And we will start with NLU, NLU, and this NLU stands for, or is a representation for natural language understanding. And for me, it's quite not a new theme, but I started to working with this year in summer when we do our internal barcamp, and we have got a lovely CTO which got the ability or possibility to move us to several directions. And so I started to write our first chatbots with some NLU stuff. And yeah. So, and natural language understanding shouldn't be mixed up with NLP, which is natural language processing, because it's not the same. They have some overlapping stuff, but NLP is more. NLP does more on the side for processing the data, working with the data, and persisting it. And NLU concentrates on working with text, and tries to find out how the text, or what's the intent of the text is. This is the main purpose of natural language understanding, and this is the difference. So we have to divide those two things. But at the end, NLP, if it tries to work with the text, it uses the same methods or algorithms NLU uses. So it's kind of a core feature. NLU is a kind of an interaction with human and machine, and it's quite directly, because it opens some communication, and it brings some structure into spoken or written words, because normally words are really, really unstructured. And a core feature or a core thing of NLU is to aggregate the data. This is the part where AI comes into the scene, and where we start to train the data, because the thing to understand text isn't done by some pattern or regex. It's really done by training, and we will see it tonight, hopefully, when my machine comes back. And I want to talk or present you some words we are working with. It's the intent, and this is the core thing of natural language understanding, because we try, not we, the machine tries to understand what the purpose of the text is. Normally this is a hard feature for us people too, because I think in our current social work we go into a direction where we don't understand our friends or other people that are telling things to us. So with those machine learning things, we try to bring the machine into the position that they understand some text. And it depends on the domain model. It's quite different when you try to write a chatbot which is able to answer some core features, which is able to interact with a customer or move him to the right direction. Or another model can be to do a real analysis on some kind of ratings on a product or reviews on a product. So it's really, really, really different what the intent can be. And yeah, as I said, it could be a different code for us people or for us humans too. The second thing we can see tonight is the entity, or we will speak about, and the entity is some kind of the data we try to extract or we try to find in a sentence. And for example, if we are asking for some kind of topics you like in some kind of asking round, so the topic itself can be some kind of entity, or the value of the topic is the entity. And I think the easiest way or the best way is to start with an example. And I prepared a sentence. It's where it isn't really clear what the intent is, because if I write the sentence into our chat room, maybe I write I have to stay at home until Friday. What could be the intent of the sentence or of that sentence? There are many possible things. One possible thing can be, yeah, maybe I have to do some homework or remote work. I go on vacation, or I'm ill. And that is the thing I'm trying to go here with the intent. It's something I define and I'm trying to train later. But it's the thing the machine has to separate or to understand from each other. So I try to fill this example. And as I said, the intent can be report illness at work, and the entity is the end date, and this is the data we try to extract from the sentence. It's Friday, and I think I made a grammar issue. Why do I choose this example? We are going today into a PHP perspective on natural language understanding. As I started to work with it, I wrote a chatbot for our company to recognize people in a chat if they say I'm ill, because you have to say to your boss, hey, I'm ill, I won't come until Friday. And doing so, I wrote a little chatbot which understands it and which creates a ticketing ticket for our Jira, because our company works with tickets even in that situations, and this ticket got the right configuration we currently do by hand, because currently we create a ticket with some with our name and with some dates for from and to, and this is the thing we try to extract from the sentence. And some entities needs to be assumed and maybe to ask for. And this is the thing where we come into the conversation, which NLU also is responsible for. But today we simply want to look into the intents and into the interpretation of those texts. So, I think I've said it before in some of my sentences. Why do we need that? A main purpose, and the first purpose we see in documentation is a chatbot. This is a thing we have had in talk tonight and or this afternoon, and yeah. But in general, NLU defines some kind of interface for our machines, because in future I don't think we need some kind of keyboard or mouse or something else. We simply speak with our computers as we know it from Star Trek, and I think that future isn't very far away, because machines really are really fast in understanding our intents. As said in the introduction, I'm a father of two children, and both are using my Alexa to control the TV, and they really trained Alexa to understand them. Alexa doesn't understand me, but they know how to work with her. And then I, a third part, which can be very interesting, is really a real intent analysis. Just imagine you've got a product and you've got a lot of reviews and ratings and something else, and most of those reviews are selected by somebody if they will be rejected or will be shown. And this is a thing a machine also can do. And a really interesting thing can be to understand what the customer says there. Because if the customer says, oh, I hate this product because I want something else, and just to recognize or to see what he wants, it opens some possibilities to recommend other products to him. And sure, having an AU is for fun too, because it really makes fun to train those machines or to see the outcome, because I think 10 years ago, I wouldn't imagine that we can do it today. What about those three things? I didn't mention it before, but we have got solutions in the market that are really good in understanding us. It's Alexa, it's some Siri stuff, or I don't know the real word of those Google Dots. They really understand us, and they learn, and they do what we want, and we can add some own scripts to them, but I would avoid them. Some ideas why? Data privacy, I would think. Does anybody of you know where the data goes to when you are speaking with your Alexa or with your Google Dot? Has anybody seen some data policy text when using maybe Google Translation or Google Communication System on your homepage? I can't imagine that it's possible to write, because normally they would lie. you can't do it together, because the server are separated around the world, and I don't trust them too. It's a part of the data privacy and a part of trust, and so I would recommend to do it your own. I wouldn't say write your own AI to interpret the text, but there are solutions out there. And one of those solutions was mentioned in the chatbot talk today. It's Rasa NLU. It's free software. It's written in, no, I don't want to say no. It's ready to use. It has got all the features we need. It has got control over conversation. It gives us the intents. It lets us train it, and gives some entities we are needing, and a lot of integrations into given chatbot systems maybe, or into other software. So it's really easy to to install it. It's just a pip install, and or if you don't have it right there, you can just clone it from the repository and install the requirements on your own. This would mean you're working on bleeding edge, but sometimes you want to do it or you want to try it. But as you can see, there's something what doesn't really match to our conference today, because this thing is written in Python. Who of you is able to write Python or does Python software development next to PHP? Ah, cool. Is it? I think it's a nice language. It's beautiful. It's but we as a PHP developers are well suited in our environment, and so maybe somebody who doesn't want to learn Python, and we want to have those features too. I won't recommend to write an implementation of such an NLU system, because there's a lot of things which has a reason that it's written in Python, as many of those AI things. And so I prepared a little decorator for Rasa NLU, because Rasa has got a kind of an API. You can start it as a Python server and communicate with the scripts, or you've got a complete Docker image available for it, and you can start working with it. And so that was the reason I said, oh, we need something in PHP to talk with it, to have the models, and maybe to have some kind of speaking interfaces. And yeah, this is the thing I prepared today, and we will change to console in some minutes. As you can see, it's I prepared some that are Symfony commands, but at the end it's a kind of a library I wrote to interact with the HTTP RPE from Rasa. As you can see, I started with some core features. It's just to parse the string, to train some data, and to see some kind of status, which data is currently prepared. And yeah, I use them, what are those scripts, as an example to see how those interactions work, that they take some time, maybe. And as I had to restart my machine, I also had to restart my everything else. Everything you will see now is inside a GitHub repo, which is a GitLab repo, which is also public. I currently prefer GitLab over GitHub, just because of pipelines and Docker registry. Rasa. So. To play around, I prepared two containers. One container is containing the app code, which is a kind of a client, I would see, and a container which contains the Rasa stuff, and which is available through the API. And we can also communicate now. PS, just to see if it's running. Yes, it runs, and we could start working with the API now. I need by doing some simple curl requests, but I don't think we have to. I'm just looking for another window. No. I just prepared my apps here on a different Google Chrome. I use the Postman just only to what? To demonstrate that the thing I prepared in PHP are simple HTTP calls, and this is a wrong project. I won't use it. So we will start with our application, and I will go into the Docker container and DockerX. So what you can see here is, I think, is this big enough, or should I do it bigger? Bigger. So. I will use another one to see that. Just for a second container to see some kind of logging. caused by, I had to restart my PC, as they don't like. So let's see. Because I just want to see if the requests are coming in, and so what we're going to do first is just to ask for a status from the machine, and it's so, as you can see in the upper. Console, that is a simple curl request what is done under the hood, and you get some status data about the currently available models and which models are training. The train data I will introduce today are really really small data, but at the end this can be an important decision how long the training takes, because this is sometimes a reason to switch to commercial products like Alexa or something else, because they have the machines, and for this self-hosted situation you have to buy the hardware on your own, and but it won't take so long today. I think there's nothing really interesting inside, so I will start training a model I prepared. I will show the model later, and I just select a project to add the data. Report. Oh yeah. I created a new model. We hopefully see it when. Yep, it's the second model available, and we can start to pass some sentences and to have a look what the answer is, because the answer is isn't a direct decision. So we let him pass a sentence, and I got an answer. And the answer isn't a decision for one intent. It's a decision with the confidence level. The confidence level isn't really high for the first one. So this can be assigned to train more data, to add more data to the training data. But we see both intents I tried to introduce here, because I wanted to prepare two of them, one which had some kind of information that my colleague is ill from two, and one which holds the information like a duration. At the end it will be the same information, some date range where the employee isn't available or isn't there. But for that situation, that are two different kind of entities, because for the first one, I expect an entity for the from and for the to value, or at least for the to value, to say from is today. And for the second, I've got a different entity, it's duration. And so that's the reason why I prepared two of them, just to get both situations. And yeah, we will start. I will show you the training data now. And I think We will move it to an extra, to an extra string, and I don't need it. You will have the complete data then in a GitHub repo, and the training data is here, and so the first lines is to do some kind of, it could be a reason why it doesn't understand it, because the machine needs the right plugins to interpret some language stuff, and there's a difference between English and German, and these are some kind of helpers you give rather to interpret your language or your text, and those helpers are really really cool, because especially ducking is not here. There's one helper which makes real dates from text. So if I say Friday, I will get the date of the next Friday, so you don't have to do the conversion of text into meaningful or helpful information. But the most important thing we see here is this is a sentence I would expect, which can come in the chat system maybe, and I signed the part which should be the value of the entity, but I didn't define an entity here. Yes, right here, this is the duration. So for my first intent, this is defined by this part here. For my first intent, I expect some kind of duration, and so I prepared some sentences. Those training data doesn't mean that you have to prepare every possible sentence. We train those machines to adopt and to be able to learn the other sentences on their own. So we just need to define enough to have better decisions, because the decision we have here on the bottom isn't good enough for us. It's okay for that thing, but there can be, wo habe ich den Englisch? Ach, there. What that would mean is we have to go on with training, so we have to get some feedback if the decision was okay. When we are doing it on our own, we have the feedback directly. When having those stuff in an application, we need to find the feedback. Maybe if somebody canceled some checkout or something else, which can be a sign that we or the machine doesn't understand it correctly. But here for those text things, we can ask for some kind of confirmation. Yeah. So, where's my Abigon? And I just want to. You saw on my console that are Symfony commands, which doesn't mean you have to define Symfony commands for them. It's just for me. It's a simple interface for me. I prepared the code here inside a folder, and at the end, it's just a definition of some kind of modeling. The models I expect, maybe. Here you can see the status stuff. It's exactly the properties we get as response from Rasa. Normally we get some JSON data, and that's the reason why I created the object as an as an immutable object from JSON data. And it's the same for the others, and they stick together. And just for the usage, I created just a little factory where I stick this stuff together. And at the end, those endpoints are simple wrapper around GustlPHP, which do the curl request for me. And it simply makes it easy. And I think maybe I should open source or prepare work on this folder and serve it as an open source solution to interact with rather HTTP IPs. At the end, the API we are currently working on isn't really complete because there are other features rather has, because if you are really working in Python with Rasa, you can do some kind of online training. So you type your phrase, Rasa will give you the answer, and you can decide if the answer is correct or not. And this is the thing I mentioned before with the feedback. And this is doing it that way, you will train the model, and training model will end up in a better decision. And normally I would expect decisions which are over 90% to be more confident for my own. And yeah. So this is my slides. I'm going back to my slides because I was really faster than I thought, and because this is near the end, and I would like to get some questions now. If you have one, if you have them later, you can contact me under that possibilities. The main thing I use is Twitter at the moment, so you can find me there if you follow me, or we can speak here if you'd like. So are there any questions? Is there none? Maybe you can grab me later on a social event or tomorrow morning. And I would like to say thank you for joining my talk. You can see the talk has the links. And I will share the slide later on Twitter or give it to the organizer. Thank you.